Hello everyone and welcome to this Moodle Academy webinar, Teaching Languages with Moodle, which I'm very much looking forward to discussing with you and sharing with you. So I am Mary Cooch. I am Education Manager at Moodle HQ. And as you can see in the footnote there, I'm also a language lover. So by that, what I mean is for about 28 years, in actual fact, before I joined Moodle HQ, I was actually a high school languages teacher in England, in the UK, mainly French and a little bit of German. And then in 2006, my school, along with other schools in the educational region, got Moodle. And so I actually began using Moodle to teach languages, and there's a French quiz at high school level, for example. Then, when I joined Moodle full-time, my languages were still very much a part of me, because, as well as being able to go to conferences in different languages, just by coincidence, I then, although I wasn't teaching languages anymore, I had the opportunity to be a language student. So, about 5 years ago, my son moved to teach English, a family of teachers, teach English in St. Petersburg, and I saw it as an opportunity to learn Russian. So I signed up as part of my learning to a grammar course, and when I logged in, I was surprised and pleased to see that they used Moodle. And then again, for my own interest, last autumn, and perhaps something I might do when I retire, I actually signed up for a couple of courses on teaching English as a foreign language. And again, I paid for the course, I logged in, and there was a very well-designed Moodle 3.11 site to take me through teaching English as a foreign language. So I have the experience both from the teaching and the learning languages point of view, which is good, but also it did make it very difficult to decide how are we going to approach this webinar and the course, because if you're like me, you might have experienced different methods of teaching and learning languages when you were in school as a student. Maybe if you are a language teacher, you have your own preferred method, or perhaps like me, you actually mix and match depending on the level of the students and their age or the environment or whatever. And I thought, well, where do we begin? So what we're going to do is we're going to take the easy way out, and we're basically going to do it very simply by focusing on the skills of listening, speaking, reading, and writing. And yes, I know that they are not actually discrete skills. You can't separate them. Because, for example, if you want to practice speaking, you first of all have to listen in order to be able to respond. Writing practice, some people use dictations, but if you're going to do a dictation, first you have to listen in order to write down what is said. And a personal favorite of mine is when learning a language is actually reading out loud. And if you're reading out loud, you're reading because you need to understand what's on the page or the screen, but you're also practicing your pronunciation, your intonation, the stress on the words, and so on. So bearing in mind we can't really separate them, we're going to try anyway and look at how Moodle can help you with these four skills and what features, standard and contributed, are available. And I'm looking forward to people who are experienced in teaching languages with Moodle helping us out with answering the questions and making comments. But before we even go there and look at the skills, just a thought about getting started, in actual fact. So we're using Moodle, whether that is blended or fully online, Moodle is our environment. And so I wanted to ask you whether you had thought about, maybe you do it, or maybe you think it's a terrible idea, the fact that because Moodle is available, the interface of Moodle is available in over 100 languages, you know that in Moodle 4, students or anyone can change the interface of Moodle from their profile language selector language. This might be a useful way of your intermediate or advanced language learners to see some extra language use as they go to your Moodle course, which might be in your target language. On the other hand, you might think this is not such a good idea for beginners of a language learning. On the right there, you can see a smartphone. And where is my smartphone? Yeah, here is my smartphone. And when I first started studying Russian, I thought, yeah, I'll put all the instructions, all the interface in Russian. And for the next few days, I was sending messages to the wrong people. I forgot how to answer my phone. I couldn't remember where to go for anything. So it wasn't such a good idea. So it is worth considering in order to give them more of a language experience, but you have to know the level and the bravery, perhaps, of your learners. Now, the other option you have is you can, as a teacher, if allowed by the admin, to force the target language, I mean the language the learners are studying, the target language in your course. And you do that from the course settings appearance. And again, this may or may not be useful to you, but I want to introduce to you a proposal or an initiative that is actually being discussed at the moment, because you might like to add to the discussion yourself. And that is, rather than forcing the language in the whole course, there is a proposal to force the language in an individual activity. And an instance of this is perhaps if you have intermediate learners and you've decided you want your course interface in the target language, but you want perhaps just one forum, one support forum, where they could just type or speak in their own native tongue, where they're not so worried about getting the gender or the cases wrong. That's one example. Now, this is still in discussion, but if you're interested about this, you think it's a good idea, or you think it's a bad idea, if you have suggestions or examples in favor or against, the number that you see here is the number of a tracker issue where it's being proposed. And there's also a link to a Moodle.org discussion if you prefer to talk about it in a discussion. But I thought, as language teachers and language enthusiasts, I hope you all are, this might interest you. Okay. Now we're going to start, and we're going to start with listening. At the end of each of these areas, we'll stop briefly to see if there are any questions or comments, and then I hope we'll have time at the end of all to discuss it again. So, listening. Okay. Well, I have to tell you that I started teaching, now wait for it, in 1985. Before we had the internet, we had very few computers. And so for many of those years, before I joined Moodle, listening activities with my students were done using one of these, which is, in fact, this exact model. It's a cassette recorder. And we would have bought tapes, cassette tapes, and play them in class. And I even used this to record at the end of the year the speaking exams of our students. They spoke into the cassette, and then we would post these in the post to the examiner, who would listen and grade them. And maybe if some of you are of a certain age, you might remember this in language teaching. But I do want to tell you that when I first started, in my very first couple of years, these were too modern and we didn't have them. We actually did listening activities with one of these, which is called a reel-to-reel tape recorder. And it was brilliant, very, very heavy. I did my first speaking exams, official government country speaking exams, using one of these. And they were great because, for example, you could use two sides. So I got very expert at lifting the two reels, taking them off, putting them back the other way to listen to something else on the other side. But you had to be careful, because if you didn't pay attention, the tape might go in the wrong way and you would have this very, very strange, incomprehensible language, which was basically inside out, back to front tape language. So I'm very, very glad that nowadays in 21st century and in Moodle, it's much, much easier to set up listening activities for your learners. Here is an example of the Atto editor in Moodle. And you can see here that we have the media icon where you can upload media, MP3 files or whatever. We have a microphone and a video icon, which is for recording yourself. So as a teacher, you can record listening activities, and learners can in certain places too. And because now H5P is embedded in Moodle, you can also use the audio features of H5P. And it's not simply a question of just adding them or uploading them. If you go to the media icon, for example, you see that in Insert Media, you have other options, alternative file types. You can decide if you want the sound to play automatically, which I hope you don't, or to loop it, or you can, if it's necessary or useful for your language subject, add subtitles and so on. So all of this makes it easier and to me, a joy to add listening activities for our language learners. Here's just a simple one to begin with. So this is a standard Moodle question type in a quiz where the teacher has actually recorded themselves using that Atto recorder. And then students need to listen and then decide what is the mood of the speaker. Angry, for example, or let me show you the student view so you can see what the student sees in this standard matching question type. So they must listen and then they must match what they hear to an emotion, okay? And you might be thinking, what's this number here? So the number one, that relates to the speed of the recording. So as a matter of fact, if a student clicks there, hope this will work, okay, then she can or he can slow it down to make it more comprehensible or speed it up if they want. A caveat or a warning about this. Unfortunately, this feature of the speed of sound recordings was accidentally forgotten when the upgrade to Moodle 4 came, but it's been noticed and they are working to put it back as soon as possible. So if you're practicing on a brand new Moodle 4 site, then don't worry if you don't see this sound speed control. It will be coming back very soon, okay? So more about audio. What you see here is an example, a nice round circular icon, which is the H5P audio icon. And this is a basic Moodle page where learners would listen to audio and then they would read along as they're listening to it. And H5P allows you to upload audio very easily. On my next slide, you can see this is inside the H5P audio. You can upload a file or find a link online and you can record yourself. So what you can do rather than having a static page that they read is you can combine this with the mark the words activity. So they listen to the audio and then they need to click to select where what the text says is different from what they can hear on the audio. Okay, where the text does not match the audio. And that's a nice little listening exercise. Now, if you're a fan of the quiz activity, question types, there is a similar question type as a plugin called Word Select. And you can see it here. So you see the audio there, which is where the teacher is reading out loud the text. And then again, you click to select where it doesn't match. And the word select question type is good if you can have plugins installed because it's very, very simple to do. So if we look at it from the teacher's point of view, you can see at the top there, simply click the Atto microphone, record the text, and then whichever words or phrases you want to be selected, which don't match, you use a single bracket or whatever your choice is, and that's it, basically. Okay, we will come back to word select a little bit later on. Moving on from listening only, of course, watching videos also tests your listening and understanding skills. And perhaps for me, the simplest way of getting them to watch videos to understand is by putting a video For instance, the link to a YouTube video, if you can have YouTube, in a description question type. Description question type doesn't have a question in it, but it is basically a big space where you can put things like videos. And then after that, you can add your questions related to the videos. And this is good to make sure that they've watched the video because they need to answer the questions. However, you can do one better than this if you like H5P, because H5P has the interactive video activity. And here you can, in fact, intersperse your questions at intervals in the video so that they are forced to go through the video to answer the questions. We often get people saying, how can I make sure my students watch a video? The only way is to ask them questions. And if you can put the questions at regular intervals in the video, then you know they have to, whether they want to watch it or not. Okay. There's much more we can say, but I'm going to stop there before we move on to speaking, because I'm going to ask Anna if there's anything now that's raised or, you know, otherwise we'll carry on.
Well, so far, no. There was a little bit chat about the vintage audio tapes you presented. Right. A lot of people remember this. And
I'm not the only old one then.
And some said that the speed control for audio file is a very good idea.
Yes, yes. So, which is why it was very quickly noticed that it's what we call a regression if we leave something out that was there before. This was very quickly noticed and will very quickly come back. Yeah. Okay. In fact, I noticed it when I was making this presentation using Moodle 4. I thought, where's the speed control gone? And I found it that it had already been reported by somebody quicker than me. Okay, well, let's continue and then we'll have time afterwards to discuss all of the skills. So we're going to move on to speaking. And again, if you have experience of learning languages, you might agree with me that the best way to practice speaking is with a teacher who is a native speaker, or with a teacher who's a very competent teacher, where you can practice in real time, either on your own or with a group of people. And what's good now is that with Moodle 4, we have the video conferencing tool, Big Blue Button, which is standard. The free tier hosting, comes as standard. So that means that any teacher using Moodle, you can do real time, or we call it synchronous, one-to-one speaking practice, or you can have groups to do speaking practice, up to 25 people, up to an hour's session, that's enough. And you can record it, and the recordings are available for a week. And what I like about Big Blue Button, similar to other video systems, is that you can, like you may do in your classroom, if you have a large group, and I used to teach languages to young learners, 32 in a class, you know, you cannot do individual speaking with all of them. So what you would do is you would get them in little groups practicing. With Big Blue Button, you can put them into breakout groups to practice speaking in small groups at intervals during your session. So that's what we call synchronous or real-time speaking, which I think is the most valuable. But because we're online using Moodle, we can also do asynchronous practice. So here are a few thoughts on that. For example, the forum. Now, the forum is a very, very versatile tool that doesn't only have to be used for writing. As you can see here, discussing the Eurovision Song Contest, they're actually using the Atto editor record audio to record their speaking responses. And this is asynchronous, so they could do it at a time convenient to them. And in fact, Skylar down at the bottom there, they decided to be brave enough to record a video speaking. This by default has a limit of up to 2 minutes, but I think that is fine for if you're trying to have some kind of a dialogue. It's not a speech or a presentation. You're trying to emulate a conversation. Personally, if I were doing this, I would make it informal, but you can grade forums, whole forum grading. And as you can see here on the right, this is a rubric. So this is using forum speaking activity with a rubric to grade, for example, the content or the style. You could have pronunciation and whatever. But of course, if we're talking about assessing speaking, we tend to think more of rubrics in terms of assignments. And so here is a speaking assignment, very straightforward, because the learner can, in an online text assignment, for example, they can record themselves, and then you have the rubric where you can give them various points according to how you assess them. However, we'd also like to get our learners to practice speaking on their own, and if possible, to self-assess. So let's think about some of those possibilities. Back to the quiz, and you'll see me referring quite often to the quiz. It's very, very useful, not only for summative assessment, but also for practice formative assessment. And there is a question type, so contributed plugin, called Record Audio. And with this, learners, you tell them what to talk about, and then they record themselves. So it's their version of when you as a teacher, you press that microphone and you record something for them to listen to. The problem here is if you just have it as it is there, you still have to manually grade it. But if you combine this Record Audio question type plugin with the self-assessment question behavior plugin, then they can assess themselves. So you see here, this is what the student sees. They speak for whatever amount of time about a topic, then they can listen back, and then they can give themselves a star rating and comment on how they feel they did, perhaps against a model answer that you already uploaded and shared with them. So that's one way of them assessing themselves in their own time on speaking. I just want to give a very quick one slide shout out to an H5P activity called Speak the Words, because it's a lot of fun, but it does have quite a few restrictions, mainly that it only really works on the Chrome browser. But I've enjoyed playing with it, so perhaps you might like to. Basically, when you set it up, you choose the language that you want them to practice and to speak in, and then you type what you want them to say. So for example, say, my name is John. And when they click to speak and they speak, it is graded against some, I don't know, robotic artificial intelligence language. So the student clicks my name and says, my name is Jack. And unfortunately, they got it wrong. And the robot sitting there behind in Moodle realized it. It does work with other languages too, but it's restricted to only Chrome. But if we're thinking about speaking and self-assessment and auto-grading, we really, really need to be exploring Poodle. And Poodle is a certified integration. In other words, that means that Moodle HQ has decided that this is good enough quality and embeds beautifully into Moodle that we promote it. It's a subscription, you pay for it, but these are dedicated tools for language teachers, and it's excellent, really. We don't have time to look at all of the tools, although I have put some information in the course and another video in detail about Poodle. So everything that I show you in this presentation, including the contributed plugins, is in the course, which will open up shortly after this webinar. So in terms of speaking, assessing yourself in speaking with Poodle, Poodle Solo. Now, solo means on your own, alone, and that's exactly what it is. So you practicing as a student on your own, your teacher in advance has decided, if you look how many minutes, what's the target time, how many words, the total words goal, and the teacher can also include target words. In other words, words that you should try to include in your speaking. And then a topic, tell us your happiest childhood memories. And then the student clicks and speaks. You can transcribe it. You can, again, you can listen to an example model answer which is never going to be the same as yours, but it will include the use of those target words. So Poodle is definitely worth exploring. Okay, I'm going to stop again before we go to reading and see if we have any other comments.
Yes, we do have. Celine and Joshua asked if the Big Blue Button, the recorded session of Big Blue Button, can be downloaded.
I think if it's in the free tier hosting, I'm not sure that it can. Not easily, no, not automatically. Yeah,
they cannot be. And also, I just lost it. So,
if I'm wrong, somebody do please feel free to correct.
No, I can confirm it cannot be, they cannot be downloaded in this free version.
Yeah, indeed. But you have 7 days to watch them. And ideally, you should be in the session anyway to practice your speaking live. But I understand, yeah. Okay, yes.
Sam says that is from Tamari Preschool in Danahu. And they have used the read-along plugin called Poodle and has been proven to be quite motivating, as you also suggest, Mary.
That's excellent. I'm glad to hear people actually using Poodle in an environment. Now, we know the person who runs Poodle very well, Justin Hunt. He's from New Zealand, but he's lived in Japan for a long time. And in fact, it is very used in many of the English language schools or English teaching environments and universities in Japan. Okay.
Yeah, and he says that Poodle plugin use artificial intelligence and grades the students, giving feedback about accuracy, the speed, words per minute. So it's very, very good. And also Joshua asks, how does the H5P speak the words component work in terms of where the speech data goes? So it's the speech to text done in the browser.
I think it's done in the browser, yeah, because that's why it only really works in Google Chrome. I was exactly not sure about including this because of its restrictions, but it's just a lot of fun, really. So, you know.
Okay. Exactly. And Alex says, I have an issue with add audio recordings. User of Moodle mobile app cannot play such recordings.
Yes, the Moodle app uses a different way of recording, and I don't think you can record with the Atto. I think you record sound using your normal smartphone features. And if I remember correctly, and if there's someone in the chat who can clarify, yeah, it then goes into your private files. So you would upload it from your private files as you would any other file in Moodle, into a forum or an assignment. So you can still practice speaking on your smartphone, but you're using the native features of your smartphone, not the Atto recorder. I think that's the question.
Indeed. Okay. Javi says that you can download Big Blue Button recordings for a week in free version.
Okay, well, we can check that. We can certainly check that as we go along, yeah.
David says, I use a Screen-O-Matic app to record a copy screen recording, such as something done in Big Blue Button to view later.
Well, this is the thing. You can put anything on the internet, and if anyone has a screen recording feature, they can record it. So, you know, nothing you put on the internet can be totally safe if you don't want it downloaded. Absolutely. But then, you know, for certain situations, it's very, very useful. Okay.
And that's all. I think we can
move on. Let's carry on, and then we'll see if we have time for more at the end. So we're now going to look at reading, and I think what we'll do is we will go from the simplest working towards A1 level, so individual words, then to sentences, then to more extended passages, paragraphs of reading. And if you just want them to explore and identify or recognize individual words, then think about H5P dialogue cards, which are like flashcards. You can have a picture on one side, flip it over, and they recognize or read the word on the other side. And again, if you like quiz question types rather than or as well as H5P, Well, I like the ordering question type. This is a plug-in question type, but it allows you, as here, for example, they have to put the days of the week in the correct order. So we're still on single words here, working towards A1. And the first one is done for you, Sunday, because I know different people start their day, their weeks on different days. And then learners drag and drop the days of the week in the correct order. And the benefit of this question type is that you can build it up from single words to much more complex phrases and paragraphs. So for example, this next one, this is a dialogue, and the learners have to put the dialogue in an order that makes sense. The first line, "Hello, Maria," is done for you. And this is such a common activity in teaching languages, and I've created so many, and in my recent studies done so many of these. This is a really nice one to do. And of course, you can also use it for more complex and more detailed reading. Now, you remember we mentioned word select previously when we were doing listening. Of course, you can also use word select for reading. And in this case, this is in a kind of grammar identification. So for this one, they have to read the passage and identify all the adverbs. So they click on them and identify the adverbs. It could be verbs, it could be aspects of verbs or cases or the gerund or whatever, or anything else. So that's the word select question type. You can also do this with mark the words. But the developer who made word select, Marcus Green, he also made another plug-in question type, which is called gap fill. And gap fill, of course, you can do gap fill in standard Moodle. It is quite tricky, and I just wanted to highlight this one simply because it's simple. It's very, very easy to set up, because whatever gaps you want, as you see, we have four there. Again, you just type your text and then use a single square bracket or your preference to add the gaps. What we have here is a reading activity practicing what we call in English phrasal verbs, which apparently for many non-native English speakers cause a lot of problems. And so they read the passage and then they drag and drop the correct preposition into the passage. Poor Bob, the day after he broke up with his girlfriend, he came home from work and found someone had broken into his house. I want you to remember poor Bob, who broke up with his girlfriend. His house was broken into. In fact, his car broke down as well, because we'll return to him a little bit later on. So we're trying to build up our level of reading from words to paragraphs. I'm coming back to reading with Poodle. And I did say to you that one of my favorite activities for learning languages, or what I find very useful, is reading out loud, because it's one thing to understand what you're reading, but it's another thing to be able to understand it and read it in a way that shows you understand it, your correct stress and intonation and so on. So this is an activity in this example where they're reading a whole poem, and then they, again, it can be assessed against an example of this poetry recital. But it can simply be the student reads a word or a short sentence and then listens to the official recording, reads a bit more, listens to the official one, and so on. So there are different opportunities or ways to practice reading aloud with Poodle. So do explore it, definitely. And if you're thinking, this is all very nice, but we do not have the rights in our organization to have contributed plugins, we can't install anything, it is important to realize that there are many activities and features in Moodle as standard, which can help you with language learning. A glossary works very well, for example. So you could have a glossary, either which you, the teacher, only add to, or perhaps you want to encourage your learners to. This one has verbs, tricky or difficult verbs. For instance, to tell, which is often, I find, a verb that non-native speakers don't always use quite accurately. When you've made your glossary, if you have a random glossary entry block, then you can put that on the side. Note, we've also got the pronunciation recorded there. And then students, either every day or each time they come to the course, they can read almost subliminally, you know, whether they want to or not, they will see a verb of the day or whatever word it is that, you want or phrase. Now, the kind of next level up from the glossary, if you like, is the database. But the database is I always find, very complex to set up. So I thought you might be interested in a preset. So that's a predefined set. It's basically a database that someone else has made and donated to the community. And you can find this preset on MoodleNet, which I'm going to talk about a little bit later on. Now, this is called Vocabulary Learning with the Freya Model. And the Freya Model is a graphical organizer for building student vocabulary. And it works like this. And if you were to have this database preset, all of this would be set up for you. You just add your information, or you can change it to as you wish. So in the middle, in the center, we have the noun that we're studying, in this case, predator. And then we have the definition. And then we have an image, if it can have an image. Then we can have an example. Of course, these don't have to be these specific words you can choose. And if it's relevant to you and if you want to, for your particular language, you can also have a translation. I didn't, but you can. And so you can build that up with that. And I wanted to show it you partly because I think it's nice, but partly also because I do think it's worth exploring MoodleNet, and we'll look at that a little bit later on. Okay, that was some ideas for reading. So let's see if there's anything that people want to contribute before we move on to writing.
Yes, we have, Ian asks if the flip cards work with text, for example, for recognizing Chinese characters.
Chinese characters, that's a very good question, Anna. I mean, I would like to think yes. H5P is different from Moodle because it's not core Moodle. And so the translations and the way that it works are different. So, and I know Moodle, but not H5P. So do you know, Anna?
Well, as far as I know, it cannot work like that. I mean, it requires an image to be uploaded for the flip cards. But what you someone could easily do is to create images with the characters. So instead of typing a character, upload an image with the character. Yeah. At least that was something I did for Arabic courses once upon a time.
Oh, so you don't speak fluent Arabic then, Anna?
No. Not even close.
Okay.
And Elizabeth says that before audio files are used in a quiz, students should be given the opportunity to try out whether the audios actually work in a practice test, which is very clever and a very accurate pedagogical point here. So yeah, no surprise in a test, I think, at least in the basic levels.
Yeah, that's good. Okay.
Joshua says that glossaries and some, to some extent, database and also workshop activities have worked well for him because he likes ways students can contribute to a shared collection and or give feedback on one's other stuff. This is very clever indeed.
Yeah,
and interactive.
Great activity. I mean, not only for language learning, but other subjects too.
He also asked if we can add an example of that Freya Moodle from Moodle.net database to the course so that I can give a shot.
You mean you want that Freya model as a database in the course?
Yep.
Well, yeah, that's a good idea. We should have thought of that before. Yeah, you see, I did think it would be nice to have some examples of the plugins, but unfortunately for translation restrictions, we can't have all the question types. But as a standard feature database, we can certainly do that, yes.
Okay. And the last one, again, from the same person, is on the subject of students creating shared repositories and database. I would love to be able to get students to create, modify, and share their own language practice activities.
Well, and yeah.
I think there is also a quiz plugin where students write their own questions, and this reminds me exactly this concept.
Student quiz, it's called, and it's very good for getting students collaborating, writing quiz questions, and adding a little bit of gamification. I'm always conscious that it is a great idea to get them collaborating, but you still have to check as the teacher that what they're donating or offering is accurate, but it can make your life in future years a lot easier when it is, certainly. Don't forget, if we don't have time to cover all questions, there is a general discussion forum in this course, and I would love you to ask more questions or share your experiences in that forum after the webinar, as the course will go on indefinitely. Okay, should we move on?
Right. Yes, go on. I will reply the rest in the chat directly.
So now we're moving to writing, and we're going to, again, as we did with reading, we're going to take it from the very beginning, single words, up to sentences, paragraphs, up to extended essays. And so we go back to H5P, looking at flashcards for H5P, for single words. So in this example, you see a postman, and it actually says in English postman, but the student here, which was me, has to type pochtalon, which is Russian for postman, we hope. So if we click to check it, yes, it is. We got it right, and we can move on. So very quick and simple flashcards for just getting started. Then moving on, this is the H5P fill in the blanks. So we've seen a couple now. And what they have to do here is, it's individual words, but it's in the context of a paragraph. This is a little introduction about someone. And in brackets, they have an infinitive of a verb. So this is with grammar. And they have to conjugate the verb correctly. So they need to type in the correct conjugation of the verb each time. So type it in. And then it's very neat to be able to check in H5P. And unfortunately, we got one wrong. It should be, I have been learning English for 2 years. Common mistake. And there you go. Now, fill in the blanks. Do you remember poor Bob who broke up with his girlfriend and his car broke down and someone had broken into his house? Those phrasal verbs, which we looked at from a reading point of view. So with the gap fill question type plugin. So you can use this either where the students actually see the prepositions and they drag and drop them in, or in this instance, they have to write them down. So you can use it both for reading or for writing. And again, because you choose the text, you can also choose the level of complexity of the language that they are dealing with. And there it is, got them all right because we're very good at phrasal verbs, which is fine. But what if we want to get their learning a bit, their writing a bit more extended rather than, you know, A2 level, get up to B1 and then B2 level a little bit later on. Oh, I missed this out. Never mind. Let's do this first. Again, this dictation was in fashion, then it went out of fashion, then it came back in fashion. It does depend, I think, on maybe the country, maybe the level or the language. I like it. I like the skill of dictation. But again, you need to record yourself. And then the students listen and then they type. And this is a very nice H5P activity, and you can record yourself. And you do need to be careful that you give the H5P all possible variations that you will accept for the spellings and with or without punctuation, capital letters, and so on. But it is a nice one to use. But as I was saying, we want to up our level a little bit and raise our attainment. So let's look at writing essays, which can be quite short, B1 level, all the way up to much more complex, that's C1 and above. So if you want to start with that, it's useful to give them what I always call a scaffold, which is basically a framework, so they don't have to begin with a completely blank page or blank screen. Although you would normally think of writing essays in an assignment, if you use the essay question type, then you can use what they call a response template. So you, the teacher, you add a scaffold, a framework. Then when they click to submit, they already have the beginnings of an essay or some ideas you've given them. In this one, which says, on the one hand, on the other hand, my personal view is. So they have something to just kick them off or start them off. And you can also, with the essay question type, you can also set a word limit. And also, if you're worried at a much higher level, you can use plagiarism tools with a quiz as well as you can with an assignment. That's a very recent feature in Moodle if you have a paid plagiarism tool. But the problem is, of course, with essays, you have to grade them yourself manually. We're not yet at the stage where you can automatically grade essays. And I'm not sure I want to be, because I don't really want the thought of me writing a several thousand word essay and some robot just deciding my grade. I want a human to grade that. But for certain levels, there are workarounds that can help the teacher go part of the way. And one of them is the essay auto grading tool in H5P. So basically here you give a title and the student types their essay. And then H5P does some work towards grading it by picking out if they included some key phrases or terms that you wanted them to include. So you, the teacher, have already added these key phrases and terms, and then H5P goes through the essay and picks those up, and you can allocate different points towards them. Now, again, there is a quiz question type option that is similar to this. I haven't used this one, but my understanding is that it does the same, but it does more. It has more possibilities. It's more complex with more features. And I did want to say that this and all other question types and plugins that I've talked about in this presentation are upgraded to Moodle 4. So anything you see here promoted is at the latest level and lower levels as well. So again, with the essay auto grading question type, you can include sentences that you want, and you can have different weightings for each of these, and so on. And finally, so if you have writing questions or comments, we'll do them at the very end. I just want a couple more things before I stop. And one of them is, you might have heard me mention several times A1, B1, C2, and so on. So I'm talking about the Common European Framework Reference for Languages, CEFR. And that has been around for quite a few years. You can see an example there on the right. And it's basically an internationally agreed framework so that language courses in different languages have consistency in where they are. And for example, from A1, which is the very, very beginner, to B2, which is where I just passed a Russian exam in, to C1, which I always think is around about a university degree, and C2, which is those people in the United Nations doing our interpreting. And if you like this idea, and although it says European, it is actually used around the world, then Moodle has a competency framework, and your administrator can actually add this to the site in Moodle. And then you as a teacher, you can either tag or connect your whole course or individual activities in your course to individual competencies from CEFR. And if that interests you, then you can get the English language version of this from MoodleNet. And so again, I went to MoodleNet and I typed in CEFR, and it came up with the CEFR English version, which you can download and ask your admin, or if you are the admin, you can add that. There's also an English for specific purposes CEFR contributed by someone else. And that really makes me want to tell you that do go to MoodleNet and explore it. I went and typed in English teaching and I got all of these different resources, which are worth having a look at and deciding if you can bring them into your Moodle course. And so the more people who go to MoodleNet and contribute, if you've got something useful for languages, the more people who contribute, the better we can build it up as a very, very good resource. And finally, if you go on social media or Twitter, and I don't mean if you're if you tweet about your breakfast, even if you just lurk or just watch what other people are doing, then I do recommend you follow hashtag MFL Twitterati, because this has been going for several years now, and it is basically a Twitter community of language teachers at various levels in various countries, language academics, language trainers and enthusiasts, not only Moodle related, but anything related to the teaching and the learning of languages. And I've learned myself lots of things from there. And I would definitely recommend you just to follow that hashtag and see what you learn too. Okay. And that's it from me. So I'm going to pass over to Anna again, if there are any comments about the writing or in general, any questions in general.
Okay, just I said that thank you for the overview. It's fantastic to have all these possibilities. Unfortunately, he's not here anymore. He had a live session to attend. And Alex says that there is a very useful plugin for multilingual Moodle environment, restriction by language. And this is an availability condition that makes it easy to show an English instructions only to English users and instructions in French to only French speaking students.
Yes, that's very interesting. I mean, I did think about whether to highlight these or not, because this would be in a course where you're for some reason teaching, well, maybe teaching one target language to people whose native language is different native languages. Yeah. But then I thought I'm going to run out of time with what I've got. I see it's 5 to the hour already. So we had to leave some out. But that's a very, very useful tool, restriction by language. Yeah. And again, not only for language teaching, but in other situations as well, other courses too. So thank you for mentioning it.
And I think that's okay. Thank you. And Srikath says that I like the idea of combining H5P with the default Moodle quiz feature. Very helpful session. A lot more to explore. That's it, all the comments we have so far.
That's good. Well, all I would like to say then is that please, if you have any thoughts afterwards, or if you're watching this as a recording rather than the live session, please do comment in the general discussion forum so we can keep the conversations going. And I think possibly we're just going to move on, and just a couple of things before we stop now.
Please, if you are interested, if you enjoyed this session, do consider to get involved in the Academy and help us grow Academy by contributing to its development. You can suggest topic ideas. You can suggest topics that we can cover in our webinars and in courses. Please check the Get Involved course within Academy. You can also present in a webinar and contribute on Moodle Academy. and get a badge of a presenter from Moodle Academy, and also contribute to courses. You can share your expertise and help us set up a course on your specialization, and of course, gain a course builder badge. Also, it will be really appreciated if you can help spread the word. Tell your friends and your colleagues about Moodle Academy and MEC, the Moodle Educator Certificate. Take the courses freely available in Moodle Academy and earn your badges and tell others and share the word about Moodle Academy and help us grow this community. And take a look, there is a course called Are You Ready for the MEC? MEC is the Moodle Educator Certification. If you are using already Moodle, you can take this course and check yourself if you are ready to get this certificate. It's really worth it. It's an international certificate offered exclusively by Moodle partners and Moodle HQ to show off your skills in teaching with Moodle. And that's all from us now.
Thank you for joining, and we hope that you enjoyed it.